Good morning, church, and welcome to worship. I'm Pastor Carla Hairston, and I'd like to welcome you to a worship experience this morning that hopefully, prayerfully, will change your life. Let's all do some praising of our Heavenly Father right now. Wherever you are in your house, why don't you stand with us?
Mountains are still being moved.
strongholds are still being loosed. God, we believe it. Yes, we can see it. That wonders are still what you do.
Bodies are still being raised. Giants are still being slain. God, we believe. Yes, we can see it. That wonders are still what you do.
We are here for you. It's a miracle. So we're going to sing it to you, wherever you are in the world. Miracles happen when our Heavenly Father moves. Miracles happen when you move. Healing is coming in this room. Miracles happen when you move. Healing is coming. Sing that again. Miracles happen when you move. Healing is coming in this room. Miracles happen when you move. Heaven is coming. Once again. Miracles happen. prison, as cruel as a grave. Shame is a robber, and he's come to take my name. Love is my redeemer, lifting me up from the ground. Love is the power where my freedom song is found. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, I'm gonna rise.
If you walked out of the grave I'm walking to, hey Jesus, if you walked out of the grave I'm walking to, walked out of the grave I'm walking to. I ain't standing now. If you walked out of the grave I'm walking to. If you walked out of the grave I'm walking to. I'm walking to. If you walked out of the grave I'm walking to. Well, if you walked out of the grave I'm walking to. You walked out of the grave I'm walking to. If you walked out of the grave I'm walking to. Yeah, now. If you walked out of the grave I'm walking to. There ain't no grave.
There ain't no grave. Gonna hold my body down. There ain't no.
I'm still out of breath from that worship set. Ain't no grave that can hold my body down. Praise you, Jesus, for what you have done. Just want to go right into prayer. We glorify you, Lord. We magnify your holy name. You are holy and precious and righteous. You're our Redeemer. You're our restorer. You're our deliverer. Help us, Lord, to be the church that you've designed, the church in the world. Give us clarity in the confusion of all the mixed messages that are being sent. Help us to know who we are, and the way that we do that is that we would seek direction from you, not from any other source. And that as a collective entity, we would rise up with one voice, that we do not let the enemy divide us over things that really don't matter, because you are the one who knows and sees and is in control. Help us to look like Jesus to others. Help us to love like you do. Help us to love like Jesus did. Let that be our model. And Lord, I want to pray for Crest Hill Church in particular, for all of our members. We know that you still see us all. We know that you have not divided us. We know that we are still a small portion in a small corner of your magnificent and never-ending kingdom. Teach us to commit to you on new levels. I pray for those who are sick, for those who need a miracle, for those who need to hear something today that will change their lives. I pray for all of you who are watching who are not members of Crest Hill. We call you honored guests. If you were in this room with us, that's what we would call you, our honored guests. We love you. You are welcome here. We want you to be a part of us. As Lord, you move to enlarge our territory as we walk in obedience to you. We pray, God, for unity, for connection. We pray for opportunities to serve and to minister to others. And I pray, Lord, for people who are not yet believers, that they would know that Crest Hill Church is a place where they can come at any hour and find rest for their weary souls. They can scroll through what we have put out and see that we are a body of believers who is inclusive of everyone. We love you, Lord. We thank you for positioning us where we are at this moment in time, because to the outside world, it may look like there's a whole lot of catastrophe and calamity and all kinds of stuff going on. But for us, we know that you know every moment that has happened and that's going to happen, and that you're the overseer and a lover of our souls, and that you see it, and that if we would just reach up to you, you will hold us and help us to know that we are secure. We love you, Lord. We praise your holy name. In your name, amen.
Good morning. My name is Jimmy Painter. I serve as the senior pastor here at Crest Hill. And today I want to have a conversation with you that I truly believe is the most important conversation that you will ever have. It has been rightly said that people are like tea bags. They don't know their own strength until they get into hot water. Each and every one of us has been, is now, or will be in hot water. Life, by its very nature, is plagued with problems. Life, by its very nature, is plagued with predicaments. And when those problems and when those predicaments come, and they will, what will you do? When problems come, we are tested concerning the potency of our professed beliefs. When life is easy, when life is good, when everything is going right, we can talk a good talk. But it's not until when life hits, and you know what I'm talking about, then and only then do we see if what we have been saying we believe is what in fact we actually believe. When the world around us breaks down and when the world around us caves in, we are encouraged to remember this promise from the lips of our Lord Jesus, recorded in 1 John chapter 2, verse 25, that says, "And this is the promise that he, Jesus, made to us, eternal life. Christ himself promises you and me eternal life. And both words of this promise are particularly important. Eternal. The word eternal tells us that Jesus promised resurrection life to genuine believers in Jesus. Jesus promises life which never ends. Jesus promises life after death. And when we leave this planet, God has a place prepared for us in his presence. That's called heaven. And according to Romans chapter 8, verse 18, the sufferings of this life are not worthy to be compared to what we're going to experience when we get upstairs. And eternal life is ours, watch this now, only and only through the cross. James Stewart, that brilliant preacher of another generation, once said this about the cross that Jesus died upon. James Stewart said, "For Calvary is not just Pilate's deed, nor the deed of Judas or Caiaphas or the crowd, nor was it only my deed and yours and the deed of all stubborn, sinning sons of men. It was God's deed, God in action, to take the tragic wrongness of this wayward, warring world upon his own heart. God defeating the principalities and powers of darkness at the very point of their proudest triumph. And God shattering the shackles of their tyranny to set the prisoner free." Man, that is good stuff. That is good news. Christ, through the cross, sets the prisoner free, no matter what you're imprisoned by. There's been a great deal of talk that during this COVID-19 season that we are in, this season that seems to go on and on and on and on, and many of us are facing shackles that bind us in that are more than just this disease. Depression is hitting so many households. Addiction is raising its ugly head. Abuse behind closed doors, people that are facing economic hardships, businesses closing, people committing suicide, shackles, bondage. And as much as we pray for a vaccine for this virus, and as much as we pray for things to get back to normal, whatever that is, that's not the answer. The only answer to the problem that you and I face at its root that may manifest itself in fruit in a variety of different ways, the only person that can set us free is Jesus. Only Jesus and only Christ through the cross. That emancipation summons us to take his liberating love to every single person upon this planet. It's just too good to keep to ourselves. We are summoned collectively as churches. We are summoned cooperatively as associations and denominations and conventions and organizations. Christ calls Christians to consistently, convincingly, and compassionately communicate his offer of life, eternal life. Casual Christianity will not get the job done. Many of you know that I am a connoisseur of coffee. I love that blessed brew. But if you put a cup of decaf in front of me, I may speak in tongues in ways that even you'll be able to translate. The only kind of coffee that I want to consume is highly caffeinated. Something that jump-starts me. You know what I'm talking about? My guess is that many of you that are at home today watching this, wherever you are on your electronic device, you've got a cup sitting right in front of you. We need to have the kind of Christianity that is not decaffeinated, but highly caffeinated. The kind that jacks us up and jumps us up and jump starts us and gives us clarity and excitement to get about the business. And I'm here to tell you that even in this COVID season, you can share Jesus. Especially in this COVID season, there have been doors that have been opened wide to us in ways they never were before. Why, as a matter of fact, what we're doing here today, we were not doing in a great capacity before COVID-19. Many of the communications that we have on Facebook or Instagram or tweeting or emails or whatever form, even a telephone call, we're doing more than we've ever done before. Can I tell you that when I take walks in my neighborhood with my dog, I'm having conversations with people that have never, ever acknowledged that I even existed, and they're talking to me about things that matter. Seize this moment. Seize this moment. Don't curse it, but seize this moment of opportunity. As I've shared so many times, Dr. C.W. Hoag once said it so well, that the definition of Christianity is one beggar telling another beggar where to find bread. And may I say unto you that the only reason, O child of God, born-again believer, the only reason he did not take you home to heaven immediately. He could. He did with others. Read it. It's in the book. The only reason he left you here was to make sure somebody else gets home. Christ calls us to consistently, convincingly, and compassionately communicate his offer of life, eternal life. We've looked at that word eternal. Let's look at the second part of it. Life. Eternal life. That word life tells us that Jesus promises us real life. Jesus not only promises us eternal life, he also promises us eternal life. We so often emphasize the quantitative nature of life, its endless nature, that we lose sight of the qualitative nature of this life. It's qualitatively different than anything else. I have said this countless times, and I believe it at the core of my being. I don't say this just because this is preacher talk. You understand what I'm saying? But I say this, as I've said other times, as a satisfied customer, not a salesman. If there were no heaven, if when we came to the end of this life and there was no heaven, following Jesus on this side of eternity is still the best way to live. It is still the most fulfilling way to live, the way to experience destiny and life and purpose and wholeness and love like we've never known before. But praise be to God that when we come to the end of this, it doesn't end. It just keeps on going. The primary benefit of Jesus to those first disciples of his was not that he added years to their lives, but that he added life to their years. During her first term of office, British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher went to Brighton for government meetings. She checked into her hotel and was involved in one of her meetings when a bomb exploded at the hotel that was intended to kill her. She survived that blast, but four of her closest friends died. 2 days later was a Sunday. Prime Minister Thatcher was in church, and the emotional impact of what had happened finally hit her, partly because of the sadness of losing her four friends, and partly because of her gratitude that she was alive. She, on that Sunday morning in worship, was moved by the reality that this day of her life was a gift. A gift her enemies had not intended her to receive. Tears just streamed down the cheeks of her face. What Margaret Thatcher realized in that special moment is true for each and every day, For every day is a gift. I got to say that again. Every single second of every single moment, of every single hour, of every single day is a gift. A gift from God. And we never know when our last day will be. And I know so often that is said melodramatically in churches to try to create a situation or to try to drive home a point. Or I've even seen it used where to manipulate public decision. But the truth is the truth. And the truth is that life is fragile. Every day we see the number counts of people that have died from COVID-19 or the effects that are related to it. And those numbers hit us, and those numbers hit us. But can I tell you, it doesn't hit until you know one of those numbers. Or if you're like me in the role that I have as a pastor, where I buried some of those numbers because of COVID-19. It hits home when you associate people you know with statistics. One man that I buried was a Marine that had survived Desert Storm. Lifelong military man. And it was this stinking virus that took him out. Life is fragile. And we never know which day is going to be our last. So we need to accept every day as a gift, and we need to make the most out of it. Peter Marshall, who served as chaplain of the United States Senate, who lived from 1902 to 1949. Great man of God. I want to share one quote with you that he said. Listen to this. The measure of life, after all, is not its duration, but its donation. So let me ask you today, sitting there, wherever you may be, how would you measure your life? Peter Marshall reminds us that our eternal life is not so much that which we keep, but rather that which we give away. In Matthew chapter 10, verse 39, Jesus said, "Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." Today, Christ Jesus calls you and me individually to divest our lives, living them according to His lordship, His leading, His life. Today, Christ calls we who call Crest Hill Church home. Today, Christ calls Crest Hill and all churches to die to self-centered ethnocentrism, to die to selfish egotism, to die to whatever holds us, binds us, chains us from becoming His agents of change in an ever-changing world. Today, let us remember the promise of our Prince of Peace, the promise of eternal life. Claim that promise for yourself and proclaim that promise to our world. Proclaim eternal life. I believe with every fiber of my being, I believe, based upon everything that I've read, all of the blogs that I have read, all the vlogs I have watched, all of the articles I have read, all of the books I have come across, all of the statistical analysis that has been taking place during this COVID-19 season, I believe that millions are asking today, is there life after death? But I would say to you that the question we need to be asking is, is there life before death? And the answer is yes. Yes. Yes, 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 all because of Jesus. Yes, 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 all because of Jesus. Jesus provides a new quality of living that is characterized by peace with God, which helps us to be at peace with ourselves, which leads us to be at peace with other people. Hear me now. Our nation is in conflict. Our world is in conflict. People are in conflict. Our world is raveling at the seams. And I'm telling you today, it's not politics, but the Prince of Peace who is the answer. And Jesus doesn't ride the backs of donkeys, and he doesn't ride the backs of elephants. He didn't come to take sides. He came to take over. It's got to be about Jesus. And it's all about Jesus. That life, that eternal life, life for today, life for tomorrow, life after all of life is gone. Hear me now. Look at me, please. That life is offered to you right now. Right now. Christ Jesus offers you eternal life. So what will you do with his offer? Bon Solomon, who served for so many years as pastor of McLean Bible Church, after he would read a Bible passage, he had taught his people to shout back, "So what?" Today, I've shared with you the life that Jesus is offering to you right now. And so you are now faced with the "so what" question. What you gonna do? Yeah, you have some options. One option is that you can turn off your electronic device and stop listening. Keep doing what you've always done. You've got that choice. You've got that option. I wouldn't recommend it. There's an old adage that says, if you do what you've always done, you're going to get what you always got. In the words of Dr. Phil, how is that working for you? I would say that for many of you, it ain't working at all. At all. Isn't it time to come to Jesus? For others of you, you might conclude, well, hey, I've been to church and I know about religion and I've been baptized and I've been catechized and I've been this and I've been that, or, you know, my grandfather was the founding member of blah, blah, blah. Can I tell you that when you stand before Jesus, I wish you well with those answers. Because none of those answers will get you into heaven. Worse yet, none of those answers will get you what you need right now, which is eternal life. Isn't it time that you let go of religion and embrace a relationship? Don't you want to be loved? I think deep within the core of all of us, we want to be loved. Cornelius Van Til, that great professor at Westminster Theological Seminary in Philadelphia, said that the heart of man is intrinsically religious. That's the reason why we create gods, we create religions, and we're always giving our affections to something or someone, and rarely do we get anything out of it. Isn't it time that you stopped all that garbage and gave your life to God? Isn't it time that you let go of all that junk and you gave your life to Jesus? And then there's some of you that are out there that right now, right this very second, and there's nobody else in the room, and something is bubbling up inside of you, and you feel something thumping in your chest, and tears are rolling down your face, and you're going, I don't understand this. I've never experienced this before. Hear me, please. That is Jesus himself knocking at the door of your heart. Mm-hmm. That's Jesus. Now you need to let him in. I'm going to help you do that right now. I want to invite you right now to give your life to Jesus and experience eternal life. I'm going to invite you to pray this prayer after me, right there where you are. Say this with me now. Jesus, I believe you are the Son of the living God. Jesus, I believe that you lived a perfect life and that you died on the cross for me and my sins and the sins of the whole world. I believe that God gloriously raised you up out of the dead so that the promises you made me, you came back to life to make sure I got. I turn away from my sin. I repent of all of that. I'm done with all that. And I give you total control of my life. Come into my heart. I receive you as my Savior. I'll follow you as my Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. When you prayed that prayer, listen to me now. When you prayed that prayer, that's what that was. That was a prayer. You were talking to God. When you prayed that prayer, this big God, Jesus himself, came to live inside of your heart. He's there, and you can't do anything to make him leave. Just like you can't be so good, God will love you. You can't be so bad, he won't. He's inside of you now. And he'll sustain you, and he'll give you a purpose and direction and hope. And when he'll give you a life before you die, and then he'll give you life after you die. As a matter of fact, you never die. You just close one chapter and open another. I'm so excited for you. And I declare unto you that at 11:19 Eastern Standard Time, you are born again. You are a child of the Most High God, and you're a part of the family of God. Would you let me know of your decision today? Would you go to cresthill.org/connect? Let me know that you asked Jesus to come into your heart. Let me know that today. I'll celebrate with you. We'll celebrate with you. We'll pray for you. We'll come alongside you and help you in your newfound growth. Welcome to the family of God. We're so excited for you. For others of you that know Jesus, and as I've been sharing this today, and as God has challenged you to go share Jesus, listen to me. Don't be selfish about it. It was never intended for you to just get what you get and literally to say to the world, y'all go to hell, I don't care about you. That's not what it's about. And God's gotten a hold of your heart today. You feel that squeezing right now? That's Jesus. And right now you're making a commitment to him. Right now, I know you are. To share Jesus with your neighbors on your street, through your social media contacts. Right now you're making that commitment. Would you let me know about that? Cresthill.org/connect. We'll celebrate with you. We'll help you to that end. We'll be your partners in your ministry of sharing Jesus. There are others of you that are out there and you're going, man, this is awesome. This is what I've been looking for. I sure would like to be a part of that church. Can I tell you that wherever you live in the world, you can be a part of Cresthill. You can be a part of what God's doing globally, nationally, and locally. Would you go once again to that location and let us know about your decision, cresthill.org/connect. We will welcome you with open arms as a part of our family of faith. God bless you. The last thing I want to talk with you about today, and I don't share this with you like some may do so embarrassingly. I share this with you because this is a great opportunity for you. A great opportunity for you. You remember when I challenged you just a couple of moments ago, challenged you from the Bible to be on mission for Jesus? When I challenged you from the Bible, when God challenged you and spoke into your life about being Jesus with skin on to people that need him so? About taking the love of God, not only in your local community, but all over our city and all over our state and all over our region, all over our world? Did you know you can do that? Do you know how? not only when you're actively engaged, but can I tell you that we've got an avenue where you can do things and go places where you may never set foot, where you may never physically be present, but God will use you in an amazing way to pour into somebody's life that's hurting, to medically care for someone in need, to lift up someone in poverty, to love someone on a college campus, an inner city, out in a rural area, to start new churches, to support missionaries that share this message of Jesus and his eternal life all over the planet. And you can be there. Do you know how? It's when you pray and it's when you give. When you pray and when you give. So I want to encourage you to pray. Pray for all of that and then some. But don't stop there. Give. You know, it was easy before COVID-19 to talk about sacrificial giving because for a lot of us, it wasn't too much of a sacrifice, was it? We just gave out of the overflow. But now we're going to get biblical, aren't we? Now we're going to, as they say, we're going to be keeping it real. For some of you, money's really tight right now. For some of you, you're furloughed, you're unemployed. You lost your job. Money's tight. Prices are high. And you may be looking at me right now saying, how dare you ask me to give any of my money? Well, let me share with you. I'm inviting you to give. Oh, and by the way, it ain't your money. God gives you every ruddy red cent you've got. And he invites you to be a steward of it, to manage it for him. Yes, to provide for your needs, but never to be so self-centered that it's just about providing for yours. That's making some of you angry, I can tell in my spirit right now. That's good. Allow God to work on that. I want to invite you to partner with me and partner with Crest Hill as we touch this planet for Jesus by giving sacrificially. I want to invite you to go to cresthill.org/give, cresthill.org/give. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you for spending your time with us today. Thank you for worshiping with Crest Hill Church today. It has been my utmost honor to share God's word with you today and our honor and privilege to lead in worship with you today. So until next week, never give up. Never give up. Never give up. Be Jesus. Experience eternal life and share his eternal life with every person he puts in your path. God loves you. I love you. We love you. Keep the faith.